Daphne Du Maurier, three words on the dust jacket of a book that will guarantee its success. She wrote her first novel, The Loving Spirit, more than 40 years ago. And since then, Jamaica Inn, Frenchman's Creek, Rebecca, My Cousin Rachel, The Scapegoat, and a whole line of other bestsellers have made her the most widely read woman novelist in the world. The most popular of all her books, Rebecca, has sold more than 1 million copies in hardback since its publication in 1938. Her paperback sales are astronomic. In 1969, when the Queen made her a Dame of the British Empire, it was presumably for services to export as well as to literature. The Du Mauriers have always been an unnervingly successful family. Her father, Sir Gerald Du Maurier, was the best-known actor-manager of his generation, a matinee idol who was knighted for his services to the stage. Daphne was his second and favourite daughter, and in 1934 she published a controversial and outspoken biography. Today her home, Kilmarth, in South Cornwall, is crammed with his busts and portraits. Kilmarth is a kind of shrine to the Du Maurier family. Upstairs, along one of the many corridors, hang more icons, the drawings from Punch by her grandfather, Gerald's father, George Du Maurier. An exile from France, he became one of the great cartoonists of the 19th century, and his high-backed ladies and starch-fronted gentlemen are the Victorian age to many of us. Late in his life, he turned to writing and produced two bestsellers, Peter Ibbotson and Trilby. Another face to be seen everywhere is that of Tommy, Daphne Du Maurier's soldier husband, General Sir Frederick Browning, who became treasurer to the Duke of Edinburgh. Tommy died in 1965, since when she's lived completely alone. She rarely sees anybody, very rarely gives interviews, and if I look apprehensive, it's because I am. This is the first time in her life that she's agreed to be filmed. I visited her before at her previous home, just over a mile away from here, but this is the first time I've been to see her since she moved into Kilmarth 2 years ago. It seems a very big house for just one person. I believe she has a housekeeper who comes in on a daily basis, but who actually lives next door. The film crew, plus myself, probably represent more people than she's ever had visiting her at one time. Usually, in the course of the week, it's just the butcher, the baker, and the man who brings the laundry.
Hello! Lovely to see you. Lovely. What's going on? Well,
you haven't been here since I was popping the settle in, have you,
Wilfred? It's the first time.
Well, you see, I know it's much smaller, but I tried to get it as much like memorabilia as possible. Remember the old settle
at
there?
Kilmarth, she's tried to recreate the atmosphere of her previous house, Menabilly, which was the inspiration for the great house, Manderley, in Rebecca. I recognise these walking sticks from the hallway of Menabilly. They belong to Gerald. They're not of any particular value, but Daphne Du Maurier dotes on family trophies.
Got in Ireland. Well, come along in. Now, there's that lovely portrait of Tommy, done by Gerald Kelly when he was about 25 years old, adjutant at Sandhurst.
Which was his regiment?
Grenadiers. That's me, 15.
Who did that?
Harrington Mann. It's got a bit splodged.
Lovely.
And this I call the library.
The small library?
Yes, I had to get rid of an awful lot of books when I came here. Because it was smaller than men.
That's Ike, isn't it?
Yeah. That's Ike.
He was the supreme.
Yes.
The husband supreme.
All signed. Mountbatten. Uh-huh. Well, let's have a drink now.
This seems a large house for just one person.
Oh, no. It isn't really frightfully big, you know. Well, I'll show you around afterwards. But, there's the room through there and the dining room. Kitchen over there, and my bedroom's up over with the most glorious view of this.
You don't find yourself getting lonely in the wintertime when it's
very quiet? No, no. I'd be far lonely if I had to live in London.
Are you able to keep in touch enough?
Well, one can't shut oneself off entirely, and then the children are always ringing up. I ring up the children two or three times a week, you see, and know what they're doing and so forth. And I have one or two friends around.
For someone in her 60s, Daphne Du Maurier seems to possess an almost overwhelming amount of vitality. Judging by the amount she's written lately, she's working as hard as ever.
You're now in your 65th year. Are you aware of any
decline in the working powers.
Declining powers. At 64, I suppose one should begin to decline a bit. Obviously, what one writes today isn't as fresh as it was when I was 21. I mean, one goes through different phases. But
I'm
not aware of sort of awful decline, kind of aching bones in the head, you know.
Do you think there is such a thing as a height of one's powers for a writer? Does a writer reach a certain kind of high point in their life?
Oh, I don't know. I believe writing's a thing you can go on doing right up to 80. I mean, look at Agatha Christie.
For instance, I mean, when you wrote Rebecca, you were, what, in your very early 30s?
Yes, but, I mean, that was just a phase, Rebecca was, and that happens to have been the most popular. It isn't, to my mind, the most mature by a long shot.
Who's that in the corner?
That's Grandpa, George Du Maurier. Not a nice bust of him. Mm. And Gerald, similar one, you see, on the right. Mummy, that's Mummy in the middle. Mm. Really nice looking, isn't it? Then here are the three of us. I'm the one standing. Meant to be on Hampstead Heath, you see. Come on, Wilfred, through the bathroom. Now, you know who that is?
That's Mary Ann
Clark. Mary Ann Clark, my famous great-great-grandmother.
You keep her in the bathroom?
It's rather suitable place, don't you think?
Indeed, from what I've heard.
You see, she was the great call girl, courtesan of her day. And
she looks rather ugly, though.
I know. There she is.
Oh, this is, yeah.
That's a better one, isn't
it? It's complete contrast. She looks beautiful there.
You see, in those days, if you were a courtesan, you lived under a gentleman's protection. And so she was under the protection of the Duke of York.
I can see why, looking at that.
And anyway, she was a very naughty lady because she bought and sold commissions, you see, for the officers in the army. And then all got was discovered. And she was summoned to the bar of the House of Commons, probably the only woman who'd ever been before the bar of the House of Commons. Poor old Duke of York had to give up being commander-in-chief. And there was a trial, you know, and the judge, thinking to be very sarcastic, bent down and said, "Under whose protection are you now, Mrs. Clark?" And she said, "I thought, my lad, I was under yours," which I think is a lovely answer, you see. Now, here's my bedroom. Lovely view.
Is that your working desk?
That's my bill desk, hence the litter.
Oh, the chores.
The chores desk. Kits there. All Tommy's childhood teddies. You wouldn't think a soldier would have teddies, would you? And here's my view.
Marvellous view.
Compensations. I write about this in Vanish and Formal. This was
part of the ritual of her day, whatever the weather, is the walk to the sea, which she usually takes after lunch. And if she does happen to have a visitor, then he or she is more or less dragooned into accompanying her across the cliff tops. Of course, it's a very beautiful part of Cornwall, and she loves it very deeply. She first came down here when she was quite a young girl, and would now never live anywhere else.
A few years younger, we came down with our mother to find a holiday place in Cornwall where Gerald could relax from the theatre. And we suddenly came upon Badinic, the other side of Forest.
Yes.
You've been there?
Yes, I have.
And there was this house, Ferryside, right on the water, and a board up to be sold. So we trespassed.
Being
a great trespasser. And climbed round the garden, round the back of his house, and there was the harbour, right beneath, and ships at anchor. And I thought, this is it. This for me, you know.
And you knew.
And so it was. Mm. And the family loved it too. Come on, Mole. I think you'd better be on the lead down here.
Found the house you wanted.
Yes. Well, then, of course, the thing was, I used to come down a lot on my own. The family went back to London, and I say, "Oh, can I stay on my own?"
Yeah.
Slight disapproval. What are you going to do there by yourself? And
you started writing.
I started writing, and that's where I started the loving spirit. House quite empty. I used to sit
first
in
novel.
My bedroom with a rug around my knees.
Daphne, what's that?
Oh, that wall. That's Far Harbour. Mm. So you see, I've come from one harbour, Foy Harbour. To another.
The wheels come full circle for you.
Oh, absolutely, yes.
and Cornwall increasingly grew on you as the years
Well, I used to stay, as I said, down there by myself. And then Tommy suddenly appeared.
It's your husband. Yes,
yes. This was in 1932. I was down there having had an appendicitis. And he suddenly turned up in his boat.
To see you?
This was it, you see. He said, I've read your novel, The Loving Spirit, and liked it so much. Could I possibly call on you? Which he did. And I thought, my God, you know, this is it again.
He was quite something.
Yes. And that was April, May, June, July. Three months later, we were married and off in the same boat to the Helford River for our honeymoon.
The best-looking man in London.
Absolutely.
And the Helford River, of course, is Frenchman's Creek.
Yes, it is. So, you see, it all rather... Well, I tell you, the only romantic novel I've ever written in my life was Frenchman's Creek.
This is the sort of romantic landscape where you'd almost expect to find Daphne Du Maurier. It's remote, beautiful, almost lush. But even here, the world of 20th century technology is not far away.
You get this. I mean, isn't this
rather
an interruption?
Well, this is it. This
is
wonderful.
Doesn't this spoil the...
What does what spoil?
Pearl Harbor, doesn't it spoil the...
Oh, no, that's industry. That's part of our livelihood. I mean, not mine, but the people in Cornwall, the chaps who work there.
So you don't mind that?
Don't
regard that as an intrusion?
It's one of the greatest things in Portland.
Very much.
Mo! Moddy! Come on, lovey. Come on, the boy. It's not all that warm, Wilfred.
No, it's cold, isn't it?
Cold, Molly, isn't it? When I put my cap on, isn't it?
You know, you wrote a book, Vanishing Cornwall.
Yes, you read it, I hope.
Of course I read it. How much do you mind about it vanishing? How much does it upset you?
Well, it doesn't upset me here because I've got my own home, my own bit of territory. I come down, the cliffs, all this. I feel it's a sort of personal thing, you know.
You've been living down here so long now. Do you ever go back to London at all?
I pass through London. I go and stay with the children when I go up, you know, for one night off on the holiday, like this year to Crete. Stay one night with one child, one with another, and coming back with the third. Rather like King Lear visiting the three children, you know.
Now, how do you feel in towns now? I mean, do you get uncomfortable?
I loathe cities. In my young days, I loved Paris. And, you know, certain capital cities, Rome, Florence, that sort of thing. Venice, above all. But, no, nowadays it's too noisy.
What's this? A boat, I see.
Now, here is Yggdrasil.
Yggdrasil.
Which was Tommy's boat, which he came down to Foy in all those years ago.
This was the very boat?
This was the very boat. Of course, she's quite altered now. You see her eye? Iggy's eye?
Tommy came to see you in this.
This is what he came to see me in.
This presumably is half of it.
There was a cockpit there and the engines underneath. And then we went right through here, and here was a little cabin. You see?
Yeah.
And it was really very smart in those days.
You sailed
twin engines. She had every engine under the sun. And then, of course, by and by, she got dry rot, and this was it.
And you sailed up on your honeymoon?
Well, we went to the Helford River in this. I mean, she was very spick and span in those days. And now, here she is, ending her days, and the grandchildren come and play on her. The small Brownings, terrific games, you know. I mean, lookings out of portholes, guns, blah, 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 all that sort of business. Well, come on.
That was one hell of a walk. I feel exhausted now.
You exhausted?
Yes.
Wow. I do this every day, you know. Winter, summer, spring. I call it Thrombosis Hill, that thing down here. It'll get me one day.
That's what I'm marvelling at. Daphne, the name Du Maurier has been illustrious for as long as anyone living can remember. Do you remember your grandfather, George Du Maurier?
Oh, no. He died in 1896, a bit before my time, before Joel was married. And, no, I never knew. I just was brought up being told about him.
What were you told about him? Like?
Well, just everything about him. Gerald was devoted to his father, mother, and his three sisters, and his brother. And so one grew up knowing all about his family, just like my lot know about mine, you know, I mean, so it goes.
He was a famous artist, cartoonist.
Oh, well, yes, he started from nothing, you know. He came over from Paris, born in France, came over with £5 in his pocket, and started to draw and illustrate and all this, and luckily got this job on Punch. And then went straight ahead, and he was on Punch and illustrated books, well-known books, you know, illustrated Mrs. Gaskell and Thacker, all those sort of things.
He changed direction almost later in life and suddenly found himself as a writer and wrote two bestsellers.
Yes, well, then he'd always scribbled a bit, you know, and then he suddenly did this Pete Robertson and Trilby, and then one that was published posthumously called The Martian.
What do you think of those?
Oh, I love them. And then he died in 1896, just as Gerald was starting out upon the stage. He just saw Gerald, who was his youngest son, start out upon the stage.
Let's talk about Gerald. Were you Gerald's favourite daughter of the three?
Oh, no, you can't say that. He adored all three of us. A terrific family man. And, I had an awful thing about him from the word go, but then I think both my sisters did too. We saw a great deal of him, and it was tremendous fun. He played with us cricket, used to play cricket with us and that kind of thing, you know, bowled to us in fine weather. And then there were these terrific parties we had up at Cannon Hall after we moved there in the war, 1916 this would be. And on Sundays, all these people, actors and people, came up sometimes, 12, 14, 15, lunch, you know. And we weren't banished to the nursery or school, and we sat round the table watching everything.
He didn't set out to be an actor, did he? That was almost happened by chance.
Oh, no, he did, you know. He always wanted to. And Sir John Hare, it was, I think, gave him his first part. I write all about this in Gerald.
Yes.
Did you read Gerald?
Yes, I read Gerald. What kind of an actor was he? I mean, from your memories?
Well, naturally, we thought he was the best thing ever. But nowadays, people are apt to say that he was too casual, too sort of throwaway. But he started that throwaway business and was an expert at it. And then people used to say, oh, Du Maurier is always himself. But he wasn't, you know. I mean, he threw himself into every part he wrote. And we used to notice this as children. I mean, when he was doing Bulldog Drummond, he was terribly gay. It was great fun.
Because your novel was, I mean, your biography of him was quite outspoken about him.
Oh, yes.
That he was an unhappy man at times.
Well, yes, he had a sort of vein of melancholy. I think as he got older, you know. And, yes, he did, I suppose, become rather sadder as he got older. But not terrifically so. Only I always remember him saying, this was a few years before he died, and somebody's autobiography had come out, you see, and I said, will you ever do yours? And he said, oh, no, I can't be bothered. He said, if I did, I hope I should have the courage to tell the truth. And I suppose that went into my mind. So when I came to decide I'd do it after he died, I thought, well, no frills on this. I'm going to tell the truth what Gerald would have wanted. A lot of people were very shocked, you know.
It was something of a, you know, a forerunner in the cult of Frank biographies.
Oh, it was. And quite a lot of his friends, you know, said, what on earth is this child doing writing about our father in this way? And but then other people were very pleased.
But what was this melancholy that set in towards the end?
Oh, it wasn't real melancholy. It was just, he used to say, even before, he was 61 when he died, but before that, he used to say, wait till you come to 40 years. And I think an actor's life, or an actress's for that matter, is a difficult, it's a difficult thing when you get to be 50, 55, 60. You know your best moments have gone, and what is there to look forward to on the stage, except retirement eventually?
Would you say you got happier as you got older?
Me?
Yes, you.
Well, certainly more, yes. About happier, because one's happy at all sorts of moments of one's life, but, more secure. You don't mind things so much. You know, one's very vulnerable when one's young. And as you get older, you become, more hardened to life, to everything. I mean, except when something awful happens, somebody dies, and obviously it's tragic.
In some ways, being brought up by Gerald must have been not an abnormal existence for a child, but an unnatural one, an unusual one.
Yes, it was rather unusual, but I don't know, we were awful little devils as children, you know, the three of us. As I was saying, when people used to come up to lunch on Sundays, and we'd sit round watching what they were going to do, and how people would react, and there, the three of us were around the table, you know, eyeing each other. Somebody made a kind of bloomer. And then there was this awful thing. Did I tell you this about coffee, about people who took white coffee? Yeah. Oh, yes, we had this tremendous thing that sounds awful, really. If any man had milk in the coffee, we thought it was terribly effeminate, you see. And so when it was time for coffee coming round, there was actors around the table, we'd sit waiting, you see, and mother at the end of the table would say, black or white? We'd nod each other, watch out, watch for it, you see. And the poor, inoffensive man would say, little white, please. Oh, there we are. Here he is, you see. White coffee, he's had it.
Yes, this comes out in The Parasites. You know,
well, that's the sort of thing.
You were a mickey-taking lad.
Oh, we were terribly mickey.
And you have an element, I must say this, of superiority, even arrogance towards other people. I don't say you have this personally, but there's something in the family.
Did you have white coffee at lunch? I don't remember.
I don't know
if you passed the test or not.
Hasn't
there? We're a bit mickey-taking, and I'm afraid I've done the same with my three. They were brought up to the coffee thing too, you know. Kits and Tessa and Fred all watched. Wait and see.
Did you grow up with a feeling of exclusivity, of being different from other people, less privileged,
myself,
less famous? Yes. Did you feel it was special?
No. I thought I was always rather solitary, apart from the sisters. We were a little gang on our own, you see. We didn't know a lot of other children. We weren't frightfully keen on our contemporaries. I mean, other children we thought were rather silly, which was a bit unkind of us, perhaps. Much more interested in older people, all these people that used to come up home. And, we were much more interested in adults. And when we grew up, when we were about sort of 14, 15, 16, this sort of age, we didn't go about in gangs like teenagers do today. We always thought older men were far more attractive. That is, Gerald's contemporaries. Yeah. You see, and had terrific sort of what we called in those days crushes on them, you know.
This is a very old house, isn't it? The foundations of this are very old.
The foundations, yes, they go back to about 14th century down in the basement, and then what we see there in the front there is 18th century, and then my predecessors built on that bit and a little bit at the end.
Were you particularly attracted to this house because it had these kind of antecedents?
No, I mean, I came here because it was the only place available. I'm jolly lucky to have it. It was the Dar House to memorabilia.
You never feel that you're too remote here from the world?
You can't be
outside.
Too remote from the world outside.
Well, some people would say you could. This is really why I'm asking you.
Well, you mean I've dropped out? I was never dropped in.
Perhaps you're a hippie, really. See,
oh, I am, yes. I dropped out 30 years ago. No, that's not quite true. 30, 40 years, yes. I'm a dropout.
When you've got a book on, as it were, a book in the throes, are you in a...
Working, in other words.
Working. Are you in an obsessive state about it? Do you live with it the whole
time?
Oh,
yes, completely. I mean, when I'm on the job working, I mean, this is it. I just go ahead and through the day and live the thing completely until it's time to knock off. Then I relax. Sups on a tray and the telly. Go to bed about 11:30.
What do you watch on the telly?
Whatever's good. BBC Two. And documentaries I like, and certain very good programmes. Certain series, you know. When they, I loved all that Henry VIII business and Elizabeth R, all that kind of thing.
Because my impression of you is of a very, you know, deeply creative person. And I wonder if this...
Sounds very solemn.
Sounds terribly solemn. Does this make you very different from other people? Does this separate you from other people?
Oh, no. Surely not. I mean, if the telephone does go, I answer it. I don't curse anybody. I say, what is it? Anything? Can I do anything? That's it. Then go back to the typewriter. No, you switch off like anybody in an office or anybody at work. It's just a switch off until you get
but
back to it again.
You don't then divide the world into the creative people
and
the non-creative
people. Oh, no, for heaven's sake. No. When you're doing your job, you do your job. I like to think I'm professional.
I'm sure you are.
Come on in.
I'll bring this. I'll bring this.
Come on, Wolfie.
The word Kilmarth in Cornish actually means retreat of King Mark. That's the King Mark of the Tristan and Isolde legend. It's somehow typical of Daphne Du Maurier that she should have coped with the move from Menabilly by researching and writing a book about her new home, the book that became her latest bestseller, The House on the Strand.
Now, I've got a surprise for you down here, Wilfred.
What's that?
My chapel. Didn't think you would find the chapel down here.
This doesn't fit in with your Greek Orthodox.
I'm many things, you see. I think, as a matter of fact, it was a wine cellar. And we found the granite in the grounds, and that glorious Lupietta there, doing that, was under the floorboards.
Do you come in here every day?
No. The little grandchildren come down here occasionally and say their prayers. Under duress, I feel.
But not you?
Occasionally. Come along to the kitchen. Now, Wilfred, here we are in the old kitchen, which is now my archive room.
Oh, yes, these are all the manuscripts.
All the great works.
Glassblowers.
Glassblowers, Gerald, Jamaica Inn, Rebecca.
Rebecca, my
goodness. Your old parasites. Wait a minute, I know. We'll look at this later, shall we?
I want to have a look at that. This is the original typescript, is it?
Well, I think so. Put it on the desk.
We'll look at that later.
I got a rush of blood to the head at one time and began to do, before I wrote The Scapegoat, and began to do paintings, do you see? Those were the glass blur, the workmen's cottages.
Mm. You paint as a kind of relaxation?
Well, I just did, never done since, but it was to remember what they looked like, do you see?
Can I see the rest of the manuscript?
And that's rather nice of glass blurs, do you see? Then,
what else have you got in the manuscript?
Wait a minute. Here's something very fascinating. Now, we'd like to take a look at this, I dare say.
Aha, original manuscript.
Original manuscript.
Memoirs of Mrs. M.A. Clark.
Regarding the Duke of York.
I'd like to have a read through this.
No, I hide that away. Lots of old papers and things. Oh, yeah, this is rather fun. Rather different from Mary Ann. The Bystead, the first time I ever had anything published.
A poem, The Old Ship.
The Old Ship.
Is your first
1929,
poem.
Published in The Bystander. Wait a minute,
do you want to read some of that?
No, but I could read the last bit, you see, and you see how very derives from every sort of and it ends up, I can hear the scattering of the sand upon the beach. I can see the shattering of the waves and the screech of the wild, wet wind upon the land.
Mm. That's lovely. How old were you when you wrote that?
Oh, I don't know, late teens or something like that. And it was published in 1929. I don't know what that is. Shut that up for a moment. No.
I'm dying to get my eyes on.
Oh, I dare say. Now, wait a minute.
This is the actual manuscript of Rebecca.
Look at the faded old notebook.
This was your original typescript.
Yes.
There it is. Last night I dreamt I went to Mary.
look at the immature handwriting.
Yes.
Because I was rather immature, you know, all those years ago. And Rebecca scribbled on the top.
That's quite something.
Well,
we'll leave that there.
Yes, we can.
And this is...
This is Grandpapa, which is really, to my mind, more interesting.
Studies for Punch.
Studies for Punch by George Du Maurier. A lot of notes and things.
These were his roughs, in fact.
Yes.
For the,
do you see,
the cartoons. Mm.
There's a very good one. But Gerald was very proud of these, you see. And he had them... That's good, isn't it?
Yeah.
He had them all bound up.
This was your husband's desk?
Yes. And this, you see... Ah, now this is my proudest possession. This was the parachute model given me the day I was asked to open the Browning Barracks. And a free-fall parachutist dropped from the air at my feet and presented me with this. It was terrific.
That was the proudest
moment. Oh, it really was, without hesitation. Well...
I must say I find it strange that a military occasion such as she describes should be the proudest moment in the life of someone who was also the author of a novel like Rebecca.
Last night, I dreamt I went to Manderley again. It seemed to me I stood by the iron gate leading to the drive, and for a while I couldn't enter, for the way was barred to me. Then, like all dreamers, I was possessed of a sudden with supernatural powers, and passed like a spirit through the barrier before me. The drive wound away in front of me, twisting and turning as it had always done. But as I advanced, I was aware that a change had come upon it. It was narrow and unkempt, not the drive that we had known. At first I was puzzled and didn't understand, and it was only when I bent my head to avoid the low swinging branch of a tree that I realized what had happened. Nature had come into her own again, and little by little, in her stealthy, insidious way, had encroached upon the drive with long, tenacious fingers. The woods, always a menace even in the past, had triumphed in the end. They crowded, dark and uncontrolled, to the borders of the drive. The beeches with white, naked limbs leant close to one another. Their branches intermingled in a strange embrace, making a vault above my head like the archway of a church. And there were other trees as well, trees that I didn't recognize, squat oaks and tortured elms that straggled cheek by jowl with the beeches and had thrust themselves out of the quiet earth along with monster shrubs and plants, none of which I remembered. On and on, now east, now west, wound the poor thread that once had been our drive. Sometimes I thought it lost, but it appeared again, beneath a fallen tree perhaps, or struggling on the other side of a muddied ditch created by the winter rains. I hadn't thought the way so long. Surely the miles had multiplied, even as the trees had done. And this path led but to a labyrinth, some choked wilderness, and not to the house at all. I came upon it suddenly. The approach masked by the unnatural growth of a vast shrub that spread in all directions. And I stood, my heart thumping in my breast, a strange prick of tears behind my eyes.
I suppose Rebecca is one of the best-loved novels in the English language, and marks out Daphne Du Maurier as a storyteller of genius, as well as a marvellously talented descriptive writer. And of course, the story is all set in this part of Cornwall. It was in this sea that Rebecca's boat sank. She drowned and was lost to Maxim de Winter forever. Now that she's moved from the gloomy, foreboding Menabilly to the more cheerful, serene dower house of Kilmarth, Daphne Du Maurier seems to me to be enjoying a new lease of life. She still writes for several hours every day, producing horrific short stories, such as the recent volume, Not After Midnight, as well as non-fiction, mostly family histories like The Glassblowers, plays, and a novel every 2 years. There are few signs that the stream is running dry. The only thing that does bore her is having to reread her books or even discuss them at all. She gets heartily sick of being known simply as the author of Rebecca, and other so-called romantic novels.
Are you going to be very bored if I talk to you about Rebecca?
Well, I suppose I must put up with it.
How did you come to write that novel?
Rebecca?
Yeah.
Well, you see, it's a long time ago, Mama. We were out, my husband and I, Tommy and I, out in Alexandria at the time. And I loathed every moment of it. Longed for Cornwall. And this story began to gel, so to speak. I began to think of two places. Cornwall, memorabilia, where I wasn't living at the time. And a house way up in Northamptonshire, where I'd been as a child of 11, and it had always stayed in my mind. This is a glorious house called Milton. And I'd been there at 11, my sisters, my mother, and it always stayed in my mind. Big house with family portraits, huge great halls, galleries, the lot, you see. And memorabilia, it was quite different. It was just a dear old manor house with nobody living in it. Much smaller sort of place altogether. And anyway, these two things began to simmer in my mind. And I thought of Milton and that place I knew as a child, but in the setting of memorabilia.
So there was an element of autobiography in the settings. But what about the characters?
Oh, yes. Well, at that time I was rather, not shy, but suddenly thrust into this milieu you see in Alexandria with the battalion went out there. And my husband, Tommy, was commanding, you see. And it was a tricky sort of atmosphere, rather. The only part I liked about Alexandria at all was the Western Desert. Well, that was heavenly. But the cocktail parties and the sort of regimental do's and things like that.
Because the anonymous heroine of Rebecca is an intensely reserved person, which you've always been. Did you identify with her?
I must have done, in a certain way. Yes, I must have done.
But your husband hadn't been married before?
Oh, God, no. No, no. No, he hadn't. He had been engaged before I met him, before. And an element of this may have crept in. He had been engaged to a very attractive girl who, I mean, I obviously didn't know. But, and so it all slightly gelled, but you can't say it was really autobiographical at all. I mean, after all, he murdered the girl. He didn't murder, he killed the girl. And it was all that business that came into it, you see.
It is one of, of course, one of the great novels of the 20th century.
That's very kind.
It was also very successfully filmed, wasn't it?
Oh, yes, very good, very good. Hitchcock, Joan Fontaine, Laurence Olivier, one of his first early parts.
Were you pleased with the film?
Oh, yes. Yes, it was terribly good.
You haven't always been pleased with the films that have been made.
Well,
books.
Jamaica Inn, you see, that was surely before Rebecca. I'm beginning to forget. It must have been. And that was... they changed the story. They didn't change the story in Rebecca, but Jamaica Inn they did. And it was all done in the studio, and it never came to Cornwall to do it. Well, of course, Rebecca wasn't done in Cornwall. Rebecca was done, the whole thing, out in Hollywood. And an enormous, great Gothic house, if you remember. Not a scrap like memorabilia, or like the lovely Milton.
Did you ever meet Hitchcock?
I can't remember. No, not with those films. I may have met him years ago when he was doing My Father in some film. But I would only have just been an introduction.
But it's probably true to say that of your books that have been filmed, that was by far the most successful.
Oh, yes. Oh, definitely. My Cousin Rachel, that was quite well done. Richard Burton, one of his earlier parts. Olivia de Havilland.
Perhaps we could talk about one or two of the other books. Have you any particular favourites among the other books?
One doesn't have favourites. At least I don't. Other authors may do. But each book, as it comes and one writes it, is the thing of the moment. It's a complete phase you're going through. And I don't mean you're going through exactly what the person is going through, but when I write, I have to become each person in turn. So it's rather like acting, you see.
Daphne, does it worry you that people call you a romantic novelist? And they don't necessarily do it dismissively, but you are known as a romantic novelist. Do you resent that at all?
Well, I don't think I am a romantic novelist. I would say the only romantic as such novel I wrote was Frenchman's Creek, which was sheer romantic. I mean, a woman falling in love with a pirate, most romantic thing you could possibly do.
But you don't feel that the other novels really qualify Mm-mm. for that? That title.
I mean, Rebecca, you can't say it's really romantic. It's this girl with this jealousy of this previous wife. And my cousin Rachel, jealousy again. This time it's a young man who's jealous, frightfully fond of his cousin who marries this woman. Then, of course, he falls in love with her and so on. But it's jealousy and poison and all sorts of things. Not romantic at all.
It's because what your novels have always had is kind of fantastic sales, but not much critical acclaim. You haven't had the kind of
reviews. You see, once you get successful, I don't think you get critical acclaim. You know, you're then, oh, well, launched, and it's rather boring.
Do you mind that?
No, it hasn't worried me. I mean, it would be wonderful to get reviews saying you were Shakespeare, you know. But I'm happy enough.
It's one of the things, as I say, it's constantly said about it, that you are a romantic novelist, but this doesn't really cover the error of work. I mean, there's your short stories, for instance,
call them romantic.
No, which are horrific.
Well, they are rather, yes. That's another nasty side to me, isn't it?
Tell me about those. What brings those about? I'm thinking right back to the
collection. Well, something triggers it off. You know, it's generally if I've been away somewhere and seen some incident or something, and I think, oh, this would make a story, or character, and it would make a story, and then it begins to come to one's mind. You brew about it, and so it starts.
Is this true of the novel, too, that it takes a single incident to trigger off
the
novel?
Oh, no. Short stories are different. No, a novel, I don't know. You can't explain these things. It begins to, something begins to sort of well up inside you. Not your own life, but some dim sort of thing of it, facet of it, I don't know. It's impossible to say, and then it begins to start and grow. And I used to say it was like having a baby, really. Takes about 9 months in a sense, you know. It's got to brew. And you think about it, and then suddenly the moment comes, then you start on the old typewriter.
And then, when the tank's emptied, the tank has to fill up again.
Oh, well, then the tank's empty, and, oh, God, you're purged, you know, absolutely purged. And you feel a terrific sensation of relief. And then, empty, until then suddenly the kind of nagging old thing starts again.
Do you think that being an actor's daughter influenced your writing?
I adored my father. And I think writing came out of that because, you see, if the person you love is an actor and is always being somebody else, you fall into the same way. I was never myself. I was always a Huguenot or a Catholic or a Yorkist or a Lancaster, whatever historical thing was occupying me at the time. And then, when one worked through that and became 14, 15, 16, I was still being different people. And then when I started writing, the different people became people on paper. And so it goes.
Well, I've read all your books, from The Loving Spirit right through to The House on the Strand and the recent volume of short stories. And really what's interested me, in a sense, there's been very little progression. In a sense, the themes, I don't mean this stylistic progression, but as far as the themes are concerned...
Same old thing, banging on. No.
The themes that were in The Loving Spirit, the preoccupation with family, with intense relationships between mother and daughter, and mother and son.
Well, you see, this is my terrific thing. It sounds rather odd, but when it comes to family and things like that, is that all relationships are a form of incest. Now, I don't mean good old bed incest. I don't mean any of that. I mean this thing of sons are looking for their mothers, daughters are looking for their fathers.
You were never, as it were, formally educated in schools, but you read a great deal when you were
young.
Oh,
never stopped. Never stopped. I mean, learnt to read at three. Reading without tears. It was before your day.
Whom did you read?
Oh, Beatrix Potter, of course. Terrific influence in my life. Have you read Beatrix Potter?
Yes,
all those
indeed.
Stories?
Yes. And then later, who did you read?
Wait a minute. Beatrix Potter, tremendously. Then I think I went on to, pretty soon, seems an extraordinary jump, Robert Louis Stevenson. Terrific influence. Catherine Mansfield. That was coming on in teenage time. Maupassant. About those four. It's a funny progress, really. Beatrix Potter, Stevenson, Catherine Mansfield, and Maupassant. And then everything else that one can get one's hands on.
Is there any contemporary author, English author, that you admire particularly?
Graham Greene, who I adore. I don't read nearly so many novels nowadays as I used to. I think this is something to do with being a novelist.
Daphne, if you hadn't been a writer, what else do you think you might have been?
Oh. Archaeologist, perhaps. Digging, you see. I'd love to have... if I'd had the brains, I think it would have been fascinating to be a doctor. Or if not a doctor, some sort of chemist, some sort of... to do with biology, to do with genetics, you see, family again. But I couldn't have been anything else, not given my sort of set-up, you know, being the actor's daughter and all this that I was telling you, but...
Have there been occasions in your life, Daphne, when you had to force yourself out and do rather extrovert things and you had to mix with
other
people?
Yes. I mean, when I married, I had to take that on because Tommy was a very good soldier and one had to go around, not too much meeting people, but after one followed what is known as the drum, hence Alexandria, you see, and all the sharp places like that.
You were the breadwinner, in some ways.
Well, I was, yes, I was. Because the soldier's pay, as you know, in those days anyway, it wasn't anything much. Got a bit better as he progressed up.
Give you satisfaction to be the breadwinner?
Yes, it did. It rather gave me power, you know. Well, not in a nasty way, but, yes, it did.
You were able to share most things, in fact.
Oh, rather, he was terribly understanding. Stop it, Moll. What are you whining for? Go on out.
You've got grandchildren. Do you think any of them will be soldiers when they're grown up?
I'd love it if one of the little Browning boys wore the red beret. That would be a very proud moment. Perhaps, what am I saying? Well, when Freddie or Robbie or even the little Ned comes to be 18.
Do you think there'll be an army then?
Oh, surely. It must be something. I mean, it always must be ready in case, who knows, something might happen. If we all give up, God help us. It must always be ready to defend hearth and home. It started with play, it started with being a Huguenot. It's gone on in a sense, not being necessarily a Huguenot, but, you know, being some imaginary person ever since. Until now. I'm not pretending to be other people, you know, I'm pretty well myself now. Well, it's about time.
This is BBC One. It's just after 9 o'clock. In a raid earlier today, IRA provisionals snatched...